When you think of Neanderthals, what image do you have in your mind? Do you think of a dumb caveman who can barely articulate and whose only special ability is his sheer strength? This portrayal is no accident. After all, that's exactly how they were portrayed, especially in the early 20th century. Even the word Neanderthal is still considered an insult in wide circles of the world, synonymous with a person who's not very intelligent and aggressive. Even the president of the United States, Joe Biden, used it in the COVID debate.
These masks make a difference. And the last thing we need is the Neanderthal thinking that in the meantime, everything's fine, take off your mask, forget it. It still matters.
It was only since the later 20th century that depictions were added that showed a compassionate being. For example, in Isaac Asimov's story, The Ugly Little Boy, in which a Neanderthal child is brought into modern times. Although the media dismiss it as a stupid ape man, the main character develops a close relationship with the child and realizes that he is clearly smarter than she previously thought. But where does the assumption of a dumber person come from? And is this assumption still up to date? Grab some tea and let's find out. When the first fossils of Neanderthals were found, scholars first thought they were a part of an early race of modern humans. There were several reasons for this. As early as 1758, the term Homo sapiens was introduced in the Systema Naturae by Carl Linnaeus, but he did not describe what constituted a Homo sapiens in the first place. A classification was thereby difficult, since also the thought of extinct species was completely unknown. At the same time, this would have been contrary to the paradigm of the time, which regarded God as a creator who was infallible in his creations. As a result, even respected scientists, such as Thomas Henry Huxley, who later became known as Darwin's bulldog, made out the fossils of a Neanderthal to be a man of a low civilization. Even the discovery of the Neanderthal 1 in 1856 in a German cave east of Düsseldorf, which was to lead to Homo neanderthalensis being given its own name, failed to convince him. And he was not alone in this. Leading minds from Germany, Britain and France could not imagine that Neanderthals were direct ancestors of modern humans. They described Neanderthal man as a malformed, lowly human being. This portrayal, therefore, also made its way into museums. From here, the step into the pop culture wasn't far anymore. But what were Neanderthals really like? We continue to learn about Neanderthals, but current research shows that we are more like them than we think. For a long time, we assumed that we, as modern humans, were the only ones blessed with manual dexterity, intelligence, and the ability to speak. The more we get to know about Homo neanderthalensis, however, it turns out our superiority is nowhere near as pronounced or obvious. Take for example the social structure of the Neanderthals. They took care of each other when someone from the group got sick and even when someone died, which can be seen in their gravesites. There's evidence that they decorated them with flowers. However, critics question whether the pollen are really from Neanderthals and not from modern contamination of people working and living in the cave. But if this is true and Neanderthals really buried their dead with mortuary rituals, it could indicate a more complex and symbolic care for the dead. Also, our cousins were similarly talented in making tools. One of them still poses questions for us today, the prehistoric glue that held spearheads and shafts together 200,000 years ago. This is groundbreaking. Think of it at best as a chess game. To follow your strategy, you have to plan your moves ahead, which requires complex thinking. It's similar here. In order to extract the tar, it first requires enough wood for a fire and birch bark for the tar. And yes, that means we weren't the only rulers of the fire. But that alone would only result in a small amount of tar. Scientists found distributions in the tar, which indicate a higher yield and more complex distillation processes. They even developed something that is still used by us today. Lissoirs are thin, curved tools made from deer ribs, which were probably used to work on animal hides to make them softer, harder, and more waterproof. Sure, we can now say they copied it from Homo sapiens, but the tools originated before modern humans even reached Europe. So, either they really invented it themselves, or we need to rethink the timing of the arrival of Homo sapiens in Europe. So, how large was our temporal and geographical overlap with Neanderthals in the first place? 1 to 4% of the DNA of modern humans can be traced back to Neanderthals, which still has an impact today. For example, the Neanderthal gene affects protection against COVID-19 infection. So, there must have been an intimate relationship between the Neanderthals and us, which challenges the theory that we actively and violently exterminated them. Evidence of coexistence is found in a cave in France, but step by step, Homo sapiens appeared in Africa over 300,000 years ago. Our next step to Israel and Greece, and thus the first signs outside of Africa, took just under 100,000 to 130,000 years. Other finds tell us that we populated East Asia over 80,000 years ago, Australia over 65,000 years ago, and the Americas about 33,000 years ago. For Europe, we assume that the first common settlements between Neanderthals and modern humans took place only 45,000 to 43,000 years ago. At least, that is what caves in Italy reveal. This left Neanderthals and Homo sapiens about 2 to 5,000 years of common life. After all, Neanderthals lived there more than 400,000 years ago. More recent findings, however, lead us back to the cave in France. The fossils found here indicate that modern humans even met and lived together with Neanderthals almost 54,000 years ago. According to the current state of knowledge, there are about 14,000 years between the common encounter of modern humans and the Neanderthals until they died out. So, were we really to blame for this, with such a huge time span, which may even be increasing due to more recent findings? How the Neanderthals died out is still part of research today, but there are a handful of explanations. There must have been violence between the modern humans and the Neanderthals. For example, when it came to resource scarcity, and only the strongest could assert its claim to it. Here, modern humans were quite in the advantage by their larger population. The smaller populations of Neanderthals also made them more susceptible to disease and inbreeding. The lack of genetic diversity made Neanderthals even more susceptible to succumbing to their environment. When they then encountered Homo sapiens, they were helplessly at their mercy, even if that was hardly intentional. Nevertheless, our ancestors carried pathogens that were completely unknown to the Neanderthals until then. What effects this can have, we see even in recent history. Because Europeans also brought diseases to America with their arrival, which were completely unknown to the indigenous peoples of South America. It took barely 55 years for the Taino who lived in Quisqueya to be rapidly decimated after Columbus arrived there in 1492. Eradication by disease was so effective that it was later even used as a weapon. But here again, we see an effect that could be applied to Neanderthals, because diseases spread particularly well in larger cities. In a scattered population with many individual small groups, a single group might have been completely decimated, but the neighboring bands got away unharmed. Similarly, it could have happened to the Neanderthals, who were also scattered in smaller populations. However, this explanation does not seem to be the decisive piece of the puzzle. Other explanations suggest that Neanderthals were very sensitive to climate change, that they did not share the search for food as efficiently as modern humans, which could result in a lower resource yield, or that certain anatomical features gave us a small advantage, for example, more efficient movement, which meant that male Homo sapiens used less energy than their male cousins. Which of the many explanations do you find the most convincing? There is one theme, however, that connects several of these explanations, and this is communication. It is true that Neanderthals were able to speak to some degree, but not with the range of sounds that we have. So, our ability to gossip indirectly led us to the top of the food chain, and possibly indirectly to the extinction of Neanderthals. Because our increased ability to exchange information allowed us to form much larger groups than them, to pass on knowledge over generations and to develop it further. This probably made it easier for us to adapt to change. How profound the language of the Neanderthals finally was cannot be said at present, because the tissue connected to the throat has not been preserved, but the complexity of their social life points to some kind of language. After all, the anatomy of their ear bones suggests that they were able to hear similarly well as we do. So we see that there are still many open questions and that, according to current knowledge, modern humans were neither completely superior to Neanderthals nor completely responsible for their extinction. The reality probably looked much more nuanced, but one thing is now clear at the latest. Neanderthals were not some dumb cavemen. They cared for each other, thought ahead, and even made tools that were used long after their extinction. In the same way, we should rethink our image of our extinct relatives, as there is still a part of them in all of us, even today.